Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to this episode of the Believers Eloquence Podcast. This is your brother Rahul Ali, the Ali Talented Man. And today's episode is going to be a bit different because there is no guest in today's episode. That's right. In today's episode, I'm basically going to be talking through an interview that I did recently. I say recently, it's been a few months now, at a civil service interview at SEO grade. It was for a programs manager for apprenticeships. And the reason why I'm doing this episode is because I've sat recently on a few different interview panels now, and I've recently sat on one for apprenticeships. And I've come to realize that people that might have, you know, tier ones and firsts in the degrees, the people that might have tons of experience in their roles, don't necessarily possess the right skills to do interviews. I don't have the interview skills to really be engaging and, you know, be successful at an interview. And I was quite surprised by that. I was thinking, wow, I thought it's one of those things you kind of think people would be good at, right? But it's one of those things that is a bit of a misconception. People generally, from what I've seen, the majority aren't that great at interviews. And it's not like it's impossible. I think it's a very attainable skill that can be done through practice. But I want to show my example just to give somebody an idea of how it might sound, how it might, you know, what's good about it, what's not so good about it, and how they can, you know, build on this and improve their own style. It was a successful interview. Not entirely successful, because I got onto like the reserve list. So I was like the first person on the reserve list. Somebody apparently just beat me to it, but the feedback was very positive. And that's one of the reasons why I want to share it as well, because if it's a good interview, then hopefully you could take a lot from it. And also to add, I did want it to be recorded in this sort of format that you're seeing right now, but my kit literally melted down at the start of the interview, so I was kind of scrambling to try to get my microphone working again. And for some reason, this one wasn't working. My camera wasn't working, and everything just melted down before. So I somehow managed to salvage a not so great sound recording of it, but it is a recording and it's still quite clear. If my voice doesn't sound that great, I apologize. I'm not using my microphone for this one. But again, I think it should give you a good idea of what to sort of expect and have an understanding of. And we'll go from there. So a lot of it's going to be my responses rather than you hearing the individual talking or the people on the panel talking. So one of the things I also want to get into is pre-preparation, which I think is quite important. And the first thing I always say, practice those examples that you have, whether that's, you know, through a recorder, whether it's through a video recording, you know, wherever it is, really do practice, because it's a skill that you can gain and become fluent at simply by practicing. Mock interviews, stuff like that are really popular, and I think really do make a difference in terms of helping. So practice it, listen over it again, and look at what you can improve on. It's a tried and tested method that works. I've got two monitors, so I've got my laptop screen and another monitor in front of me, so that helped me with my notes. So what I did was I put my notes on my laptop screen, because that's where the camera is, and when I was talking to the panelists or when I was being interviewed, if I'm just looking at my notes, they'll be none the wiser that I could be reading off it if I needed to. And then I didn't really need to, but it was there just in case. And I had the panelists on the on my bigger screen, and I did tell them about that, just to give them a heads up and not show that I'm not looking at them, basically. Also, what I did was, in terms of dress code, I just wore a black t-shirt. Some people might want to wear a shirt to play it safe. Civil service is kind of fairly casual, so it wasn't too bad. I just wore a black t-shirt and that was fine. I didn't have any weird looks or anything like that. And they will know you're from home, so I don't think they're entirely expecting you to be fully suited and booted. In other areas it might be the case, but in here it wasn't. Also to add another thing I did, and another thing I think a lot of people can do when you're, especially for civil service jobs, is carefully examine the job spec with the skills and competencies to sort of map out what they could possibly ask for. What does that mean in translation? So if in the job spec it talks about liaising with like various different stakeholders or different teams, and then in the skills required it mentions stuff about having great communication skills or great stakeholder skills, then in the competencies or behaviors listed it says that they're going to assess you on communicating influence, if one of them, then you can simply draw a line there and say, okay, communicating influence in good stakeholder / communication skills and liaising with a variety of different stakeholders. So the chances are they'll ask you a question about when you've had to liaise with different, or when you've had to communicate with different stakeholders to communicate a certain message or get them around to your way of thinking. So that's a simple way of doing that analysis, and you could do that a lot more and practice it, so to kind of figure out what they might ask. And I found that when I've done it properly, I've been fairly good at predicting what they could potentially ask at the interview, which makes the prep a lot easier, basically. Okay. I think that's everything from the pre-prep side. It's a cold Sunday morning, or just an afternoon now, and it's a bit cold in my room, so hence why I'm wearing my my robe. So please don't judge me on that. Let's begin. So one of the things that's important, I think, for any interview is conversation. What do I mean by that? So that means just being that, having that sort of small talk, breaking the ice, and just being good at doing that. So questions you could ask are, how are things going in the office? How is it working from home? You know, if you're going into an office, is it really nice or is it really busy? How do you get your way around it? Just a simple question that shows a bit of interest and that breaks the ice for the panel members, because, you know, if they warm up to you a bit more and if they like you and connect with you better, then chances are that they'll score you better as well, or they'll want to score you better. Because I remember when interviewing a candidate, the other panelists really wanted to score them more highly because they liked their personality and they had a warmth to it. And essentially, that was it. They wanted to find reasons to score them higher. Like, then they were actually like, you know, what they were worth in terms of the merit. So if you can break the ice and have a nice conversation, bust a few jokes, or like those small kind of jokes, and just kind of get them comfortable, then I think that's really a good way to like start it and have a good impression, like have a really good first impression for your panelists, and that will, you know, hopefully reward you at the end of the interview. So that's really important, small talk, don't forget that.
Perfect, cool.
Okay, I accidentally pressed play there. Okay, let's get into it. Cool. Let's see. Let me try to find the spot where it started.
Cool. And as you may already know, I'm Rahil. I'm currently an early talent manager at Government Digital Service. And I appreciate you taking the time out to meet me, because I know I didn't meet the initial date. So I might be making a lot of candidates wait right now. So I do appreciate this.
So I went on holiday and basically asked to push back the date of the interview. That's all. But it wasn't really a big issue, so don't worry about that.
Perfect. Cool. Yeah, and I've got two monitors, so if you see me looking like up there, then it's because I'm looking at you guys on the screen. Yeah.
The point about the monitors I mentioned.
Yeah, so currently I'm in Government Digital Service. I am an early talent manager, and I guess I'm looking...
So they asked about what I'm currently doing. I couldn't find a small talk part that I did because I think I had so many issues in my tech. That's probably the icebreaker that I had with these lot. So, but normally I would have some small talk, obviously, as I mentioned.
I'm in Government Digital Service. I am an early talent manager, and I guess I'm looking after all things early talent related. So that ranges from fast stream, the onboarding, the placements, apprenticeships, the strategy, looking at internal engagement, external engagement, how we're looking to plan those pipelines, summer diversity interns as a way to kind of diversify our digital data technology fast stream pipeline, looking after that process and the interns who are with us right now. Also looking at stuff like outreach, how are we looking to engage sort of schools and colleges to ensure that we're reaching out to diverse audiences to promote careers in GDS and DDAT, so digital data technology. Also other things consists of things like movement to work. So working with Job Centre to kind of look at sourcing placements for I think 18 to 30 year olds in GDS and potentially looking at keeping them on for longer as a way to tackle wider unemployment. There's a very wide scope in terms of what I do, and I think the way I manage it is just kind of looking at the timeline, look at where peaks and troughs are and trying to balance it around there. But it's been a very interesting road. I'm an early talent person. I'm really passionate about building that pipeline, really passionate about growing people and developing people. And this is something that I've had a chance to really kind of start off from scratch at GDS and building it from the ground up, really. Does that answer it?
I should say as well, one thing that I do and is a practice, which I just realized, is what I just said there. Does that answer the question? That's simply just to make sure that I've covered all the bases, and if there's follow-ups that they need me to cover or anything I didn't cover, they'll ask me there, and I can basically make sure I've done my bit to answer the question where possible.
It's a good question. So if I go back 5 years ago yesterday, I started my apprenticeship in government, the Civil Service Fast Track Apprenticeship.
So they then asked about why I'm interested in the role. I go basically pour out my heart in this one. But just, yeah, take a listen. And what I try to do is try to relate to like a story, try to make it seem that I'm actually interested and I'm actually passionate about the role, which I am. So, you know, it's all real. But, you know, where that can align and where you might be struggling to think, okay, what can I actually say or how can I show I'm interested, to see if this can help trigger any thoughts or ideas.
Civil Service Fast Track Apprenticeship, and that was my way in for a career that would have never ever occurred to me coming from where I was in my community background. It never ever occurred to me civil service would be such a career. And going through that apprenticeship experience, and even though there were parts that didn't go so well, I think it really helped me to shape my character, my values, and what I stood for, and gave me the drive to want to develop. And that experience, I think, made me value apprenticeships a lot more and made me see why apprenticeships are such a great tool to really building a diverse talent pipeline and really create opportunities for young people and even internal staff. And in all my roles in government in the 5 years, apprenticeships has played a big part. So even in my little role in cabinet office, working as a diversity events coordinator, I was doing outreach events to promote the fast track to diverse audiences. So I always knew the importance of diversity, why it's important to be yourself, to become the best version of yourself, and also how apprenticeships can actually meaningfully link into stuff like social mobility and D&I rather than it just being like a buzzword. And then my sort of current role as a talent manager, there's a wide range of scope in terms of like looking at grads, looking at interns, looking at apprentices, but my main interest is also in apprentices. And I think the time has come for me to now, I've had a taste of being on an apprenticeship, I've had a taste of doing the outreach events, I've had a taste of the different kind of schemes that are available in government. Now I think I want to specialize and get real knowledge in, not knowledge, but more expertise in the apprenticeship space, and also the kind of the growing and coaching, developing individuals element of, you know, helping apprentices achieve their qualification. And, you know, there's one thing about doing an apprenticeship and doing the standard and the qualification, but there's another thing about coaching and making an apprentice make the most of the experience, which I felt was missing from my experience, and something that I want to look to do. And an area like cybersecurity, which is, you know, a very, very immature kind of function, is very maturing, it's expanding massively. Apprentices are going to play a big part there. And I think this is the time, I guess, to get in and do some amazing work here.
So what did I do there? And what are some of the things you can learn from that? So in terms of the why, I made it very relevant to my story and my interests and my passions. And then I also, when speaking about the role, I sort of touched upon how it could help me with my development going forward and my growth going forward, which I think kind of gives compelling reasons, because if somebody's telling you that they want in your role because there's a genuine passion, it aligns with what they want to do, it aligns with their kind of their interests, their hobbies, and what sort of energizes them and where they see potential. And then they also say how this role is going to develop them and how they really want to develop on these skills, maybe specialize, maybe look at this area, this function, this perhaps needs a bit more development and they want to grow with that. Then it's sort of, I guess, what you sort of want in someone, isn't it? In terms of like someone that's interested and passionate and they want to grow in the role, and that's what this role will offer them. I also had a some water with me, which is really important because you don't want your voice to go whilst you're talking. So here, this question. So this is about changing and improving, I believe. Let me just double check. Okay, so this question is about changing and improving, and it was about how I've implemented change and in an organization and how I engage stakeholders during the process. So a wide range of stakeholders during the process. So one thing I do as well is just write notes in case I forget. So the buzzwords, that just helps me to figure out what they're asking for. And if you needed, you can ask them to repeat the question as well, and they will do so.
Just writing it down so I don't forget anything. So implement a change in the organization and how I engage stakeholders in this process. Yes, so my role when I started as an early talent manager at Competency Service, it was a brand new role. So there wasn't any sort of central early talent strategy, planning or governance. And the service previously provided was scattered across the business. It was ad hoc and stakeholders were unsure of the process. And it left a lot of programs at risk because if there was, for example, a budget issue and there's this program scattered around different areas that they could just be cut, and there wasn't a vision or goal, what are we doing with early talent, how are we actually looking to build in a pipeline, how are we looking to get involved in different schemes. So when I...
That was the situation. So I should add, when structuring the examples, I'm sure you've heard of the STAR technique, situation, task, action, result. So that was the situation, and I gave the whole context of what I'm doing and the implications of why is an issue if this is not being addressed or if this is not being worked on, basically. And the next part will be the task.
Scattered across the business, it was ad hoc and stakeholders were unsure of the process, and it left a lot of programs at risk because if there was, for example, a budget issue and there's this program scattered around different areas that they could just be cut, and there wasn't a vision or goal, what are we doing with early talent, how are we actually looking to build in a pipeline, how are we looking to get involved in different schemes. So when I came in, it was something that I had to build from the ground up. And there was, the first thing I did, I guess, was scope out what's currently going on. So I took the initiative to speak to, you know, different.
This is now the action, and this is where I use the buzzwords, taking the initiative, taking responsibility, and all that stuff, basically. So I try to emphasize exactly what I did, not what we did, or my team member did, or my dad did, what I did. So don't forget that. It's all about I in this.
Leads of the different areas. So for example, with the file stream, there was a capability team and they kind of looked after the bit of element of the file stream. So I spoke to that lead and found out about that. What's the process? How does it work? What's the guidance? What's the timelines? And kind of putting it into like an early talent map. So that was part of, I guess, you know, looking at how we can put a map in, like a timeline in, and setting the guidance, setting the processes, and the induction for intern individuals, and also giving line managers the guidance and information they need to onboard and how to also get involved in the bids process, which they didn't know before. Also looking at the strategy. So there wasn't an early talent strategy. For me, it was, okay, after having these discussions with the different professional leads, was like, okay, GDS has an apprenticeship target of 2.3% of the headcount. GDS is committed to fast streamers as well. And GDS wants to kind of diversify the talent pipeline. So why is it not a strategy? So for me, okay, I wrote a report up and I set a strategy. So we're going to use a talent to create a diverse talent pipeline to fill in the hard to fill in roles and skills gaps that are going to be upcoming in the future. And it was aligning all the programs with that. So I also met, I guess, with apprentices, fast streamers, and I got a feel of, okay, what's your experience been like? What have you been sort of doing? Have you had line manager support? Do you think they have enough guidance? And I support to line managers as well, and set those one-to-ones. And have your experience been with apprentices? do you guys, you know what you're doing with them? And speaking to business leads, what's the vision? You know, are you guys just bringing them in for the sake of it, or are you, do you know what to do with them? Because some of them didn't know what level to expect their parents to be in. So it was kind of mapping that out into common themes and then putting in place the mechanisms, I guess. So what were the mechanisms? So the first thing was the strategy. The second thing was the governance. So, you know, things like, are we aligning the training needs of our apprentices to the business requirements? So if a business, for example, the developer community, a lot of their roles are at grade 7 and there's a flat structure. So how can we use apprentices to kind of help with that structure to build a pipeline in, so you're not having a high attrition rate, but you're keeping individuals in and engaged, increase the whole engagement. Other stuff was setting in quarterly meetings with the different talent individuals, apprentices, file streamers, getting a feel of what the experience has been like. You know, are you getting the right support? Is your placement going okay? So just doing that element of it, the governance, the strategy, the risks as well, which I didn't mention. Okay, so if there's not enough bids for file streamers, what implications does that have on the organization in terms of the A-talent program? And creating a risk register to highlight that and driving the conversations with the portfolio management office and finance to say, okay, look, if you don't have the budget, this is going to be implications for the apprenticeship target. If we don't have the budget, it's our commitment for fast streamers. Where's the cost going to come from? And I think it was basically putting in from the ground up governance processes, guidance, feedback mechanisms, and a strategy from scratch to have an A-talent program. And to conclude, I guess the feedback mechanisms were now, well, not what we're talking about, clearly lost my train of thought there, but the outcome of that now was, so as a result from there not being any A-talent strategy or central program.
So one thing you may notice is when I completely lost track, I just took a little moment and just kind of, rather than going blank and just like saying nothing at all, just said, okay, wait, just some track of thought, let me get back into it. So just kind of keeping them still in the loop and just going straight back into the answer, basically. Let's go back into that.
Leads of the different areas. So for example, with the file stream, there was a capability team and they kind of looked after the bit of element of the file stream from scratch to have an A-talent program. And to conclude, I guess the feedback mechanisms were now, well, not what we're talking about, clearly lost my train of thought there, but the outcome of that now was, so as a result from there not being any A-talent strategy or central program, there is now a central program. We've got guidance, we've got governance, we've got some budget now, thankfully. It took a long time. And I've received a lot of positive feedback. One business sort of manager even wrote a short paragraph for me to go on my performance review, because she was very pleased that in her area of strategy and engagement, they now knew how to find out about fast streamer processes and how to go about navigating the business process, because for them it was quite complex. But for me, again, doing the process maps, aligning everything, setting the inductions for fast streamers, having a checklist, it improved it massively. Did that?
So that was the outcome part, which I think was the weakest bit of this particular example on changing and improving. Another thing I want to add was when I was saying the actions, you may notice I was going into it a lot. A good practice, I think, would be once you're getting near the end of it, just sort of summarize what you actually did, because people won't tell you this, but when the interview panelists are taking their notes or typing their notes, they don't always catch everything. Like in most cases, they probably might miss quite a few things. So if you're going and reinforcing it and going back into it, then it really does help them to trigger what you actually said before and write down more notes and hopefully capture more evidence that you've covered the example. So in this sense, the outcome I don't think was the best, because I didn't exactly see what the tangible result was. And this one, I think I scored the lowest. I scored a 4, which is a pass. The highest score scores a 7, but anything above a 4 is acceptable. And anything above a 4 basically is a pass and going forward. If you get below 4, then you fail the whole interview, basically, if you won 3 or below. But yeah, I don't think the result was as good. I think it could have been better. There could be more emphasis into what it actually achieved. And I think I did get a follow-up on this. So I do see here again, I do ask, did I cover the answer? Let's see.
It improved it massively. Did that answer it? So for me, there was two things, I guess. Firstly was making myself present and make sure people know that I'm the early talent lead manager. You know, I'm the person they come to for queries. And often, because of my presence and going out and reaching out to different business leads and giving them a discussion about early talent and the different schemes, they'd often know if there was a particular issue or if they could come to me. And also the feedback mechanisms. So I think at different points of programs, whether it's like towards the end or the middle, like normally it was quarterly, I would sort of reach out to apprentices and line managers to get a feel of what's going on. How's it going? Do you have enough support? And is there anything there? And again, if there were common themes, it would be stuff like, okay, maybe there, for example, the 20% off the job learn time wasn't clearly understood. So I clearly had to put some guidance in there where we have a wiki page, for example, that everyone finds the guidance on there, but there wasn't nothing for apprentices, apprenticeship. So I put in that guidance there. So it was improving it as we go along and getting that feedback on a sort of quarterly basis just to ensure that everything's relevant. Did that cover it?
So I think they asked there about how I made sure that I was present and people knew about the early talent processes, which was a slightly tangent in terms of a follow-up. And let's be honest, I probably waffled that answer there, but I did cover it. And as you pretty goes about saying in interviews, everyone does waffle. So sometimes it's the art of learning how to waffle properly. And you do exaggerate your examples quite a lot. But that's sort of part and parcel of every interview because you have to sort of sell yourself in some sort of way to, you know, really show your examples and show that you're, you know, right for the job. So that was changing and improving. The next one, I believe, is going to be about communicating and influencing. So let's see what that question was. And please do excuse the background noise. This is my laptop microphone. This has captured everything that's going on outside as well.
So this will be about how to deal with opposing views with stakeholders and negotiating a consensus and trying to get around that. So yeah, so in this example, so again, some months into my role at Government Digital Service as an early talent manager, there was an overspend in GDS's budget. This led to a recruitment freeze, and essentially the talent pipeline for apprentices pretty much was at risk because managers couldn't put in any bids for apprentices now because they were told that their roles have to focus on business critical. Often that meant, you know, senior people or potential contractors to come in. There was also a sort of growing concern among stakeholders that, number one, there was little capacity to support apprenticeships, and number two, there wasn't really a way for them to do it. So why would they want to invest in an apprentice now where there could be a business critical role they need to fill in? And this was kind of from sort of business leads to some SCS as well. So I guess my first course of action was raising this with my team lead to say, okay, look, we've got a recruitment freeze. As a result, how are we going to invest in our apprentices? Because, you know, how are we going to bring in apprentices? Sorry, because without this, we can't go out and recruit apprentices. We've got a target to hit. There's going to be some challenges there. And they're like, okay, yeah, they were on board. But then I think I had to go to the project management team and the finance team and negotiate with them. So this is like where they were saying, we don't have the money. We don't have the money. It's very tight. And there's me thinking, you know, I've come in to build a whole talent program up and you guys are telling me there's no money. What's going on here? But I think for me, it was, okay, what are the concerns? How bad is it? And, you know, what's their point of view to really understand that and get that view? Because I think in order to, you know, understand a situation with disagreements, you really need to understand the point of view from others and emphasize with that, because otherwise they'll be more defensive than kind of give you what the actual insight is. So again, what they said was the apprenticeship budget is, you know, the whole budget is really tight and we don't really have anything in place for apprentices. My proposal was, can we look at least ring fencing a small amount of, you know, whatever we can for this, because Number one, I understand that the concern is, you know, finance and the budget. But if we are thinking about it from a slightly bigger picture point of view, if we're not bringing in early talent and we're going to be filling in those future hard to fill in roles or skills gaps, then we're going to be investing in contractors. We're going to be investing in more senior people. That takes time for recruitment. That takes time for contractors. Their fees are ridiculously high. Then it's like your costs are going to be driving up elsewhere. And not only that, people, because the structure is very flat at GDS or the portfolio management office, it's like if people are just staying at one grade, then they like to drop off quicker. So we're going to feel the effects of not having an early talent pipeline at a much sooner point. So at a point where it's going to be much worse and we could have done something about it here. So I think it was just kind of negotiating that and getting them on board, and they did come on board with it. And they did acknowledge that, you know what, okay, if we are going to do it, how are we going to do it now? So it was trying to convince them, okay, look, we're not going to just do it for any old, maybe typical business admin apprenticeship. We're going to look at, okay, maybe cybersecurity, that's an area of that's going to grow and be in demand. Data, that's growing massively in GDS. And the developers always need that technical skills. So it's about focusing it on the places where we're going to need it. And that's how I got them on board. But then it also had to go to the deputy directors in my sort of operational function team. So just in the operational side of things. And for them, again, it was like, because the project finance team needed their buy-in or needed their approval. So I was like, okay, this is a situation. This is like, what we're going to do about it. Drafted a paper, kind of clearly highlighted the context, the background, the proposals and implications if we don't do it. And some of the, I guess, views they had was, again, how much can we put in? Because if you, the deficit, basically, I took some context. So when I joined, GDS had already missed the previous membership target. So it's already gone up. So they were like, okay, are we going to now have to fund all of this now? How are we going to do that? So I was having that discussion and I said, okay, look, again, you know, we understand the DNI stuff. We understand how this can be a driver for social mobility. This can be a driver for creating that pipeline. But also to kind of bridge the views, like, okay, look, we don't need to put the whole thing towards external. We can allocate half or maybe even a bit more to internal apprenticeships and internal staff and focusing on that and those skills gaps. So it was having those discussions and getting them on board, and they agreed. And I think the main thing was bridging the points and then putting across my view rather than just going all in and be like, no. So kind of using that to build an understanding and leveraging that to kind of find a proposal. So they bought into it, and the paper went to the SES executive team and they approved the proposal. So there are two proposals given. One was focus it all on internal, which we could do, but it wouldn't be ideal. And the other was, okay, let's at least ring fence some for external. So they approved that proposal, and 1% of the GDS payroll budget was now allocated for external apprentices, and the rest we're now focusing on internal. So we managed to get a good outcome from quite a awkward, precarious situation. Did I cover that?
So that was communicating, implementing. I don't think I specified the task that clearly, but I did go into what I was setting out to do, which I guess sort of covers it. And I did mention a lot of different stakeholders. I sort of touched upon the different ways I communicated with them, tried to get their viewpoints, tried to bridge the understanding, try to leverage that kind of leverage their perspective to the wider perspective in terms of, okay, what's the wider goals of the organization, what are your concerns, where can we perhaps compromise, all that kind of stuff. And I sort of embedded all those into my actions. It was a bit long to listen to, but I think it might give you an idea of, especially communicating, implementing, in terms of what sort of context are you doing it in, who you're engaging with, and how you're tailoring it. Because I spoke to the project management and finance teams differently to how I spoke to the senior teams, for example. I communicated them in a different method. So I think it's just worth taking that into account and factoring that in when you're giving your example. We'll move on to the next one. And yeah, it's a lot of, not waffling, but there's a lot of information and detail, and it can be quite hard to listen back to, not going to lie.
Team spirit.
So this is about working together.
Delivering a piece of work, agreeing, collaborate, like having a cross kind of collaboration approach, working with different stakeholders from different organizations and creating a team spirit. Does that? Okay.
That was a long question.
Spirit. Does that? Okay. Perfect. Yeah, okay. So just get my head around this one. So, yeah. So working in my previous role as a diversity events coordinator. So this was like coming in and getting well out of my comfort zone. So this was like 4 weeks in. I found out that I would be given a team of Fastream ambassadors to support the outreach work that I'm doing in my role. And that was, you know, great because I could have some support, but that was a challenge because there was no team like this ever before. There was no structures before. And also due to the timing, which was around August, they were undergoing their placement rotations. So there was also a delay in getting started, and the campaign window was coming up within a month, just over a month's time. And that caused a bit of uncertainty. And also, just to add a bit more context, I was managing the autism internship as well, kind of coordinating that, and that was coming to its end. And I was also supporting marketing because they really needed ambassadors for their diversity work. So there were a lot of different things going on there. The main focus, I think, is going to be on the team that I built from sort of scratch and working with a lot of fast streamers, but also working with other stakeholders in other areas of work. So to manage this was a bit of a big task to get into, but the fast streams are across different departments and in different areas and different years as well, I believe. So I firstly sort of set a timeline and a short kind of timeline to say, okay, well, what deadlines are coming imminently and who do I need to work with first to get things sorted? So I realized, okay, I'm going to need to do perhaps more coordination with the autism internship program and supporting my stakeholders, the marketing team, to get their diverse fashion ambassadors. But at the same time, I can now, with a small window, I can delegate some of the work with my new team for the fast stream outreach work to kind of, I guess, put in the seeds and get it started, because it was coming up very soon. We had a number of events coming up, but we didn't have an organized team approach, or there wasn't any collaboration, or there wasn't a way to deliver the work yet. But what I did was I sort of firstly set a phone call meeting or teleconference with my team, and I outlined, okay, this is the sort of expectations, but this is why it's important. You know, we're going to be doing diversity outreach work, and I want you guys to be involved. I want you guys to take the lead. I want you guys to really be part of it, because, you know, diversity is super important for me, and I really wanted them to get that across, that, you know, it's not just a tick of the box. No, it's something where we're really inspiring people from backgrounds that would have never come across such opportunities to consider this and know that they can be who they are. And kind of, I think starting off with the why of any team and what you're doing is something that starts kind of creating the purpose and spirit, if anything. If there's no why, if there's no purpose, then where would the team spirit be? Because they wouldn't really know what's going on. I also set sub-teams and looked at appointing team leads. So we had sub-teams, for example, for those that are doing the analysis, collecting the feedback, those that are doing the reporting, those that are kind of doing the coordinating for fast-stream volunteers to make sure we have enough people for each event, and setting teams. So they had a remit of work. They knew what direction we were heading in. It was coordinated, and they knew, you know, what to do, and setting them deadlines. So, you know, we need this by this time. Can you get it done? And also, it wasn't just a case of, you know, okay, I'm really busy, here's the work, go ahead. No, I kept in touch with them. I had those kind of twice weekly calls to make sure they know what they're doing, they're going in the right direction, and kind of got their points of view as well. So, for example, one suggested, okay, let's use Slack as a cross-government channel to really communicate with them quickly. And I thought that's an amazing idea. So we used that, and straight away, that made a positive impact because we were collaborating in live time, the teams had their own channels, and we were doing things a lot quicker and a lot more effectively. The communication was way better. And I think taking into account the different points of views, because they're all very talented and, you know, they're all kind of, you know, fast streamers, future leaders. So having that part and giving them their remit, but also giving them the support. So there was a moment where, for example, because of the rotations, one of the teams, when it came to like doing the coordinating, they were a bit short because someone was in the middle of transition to a new placement. So I kind of reassessed that workload and I got some people from the reporting team, which wasn't as imminent or the deadline wasn't coming up as soon. I got them to support that. So it was keeping in touch, looking at the workload, getting a feel of how they're doing, giving them the support, giving them the encouragement and reminding them of why we're doing it. And at the same time, you know, whilst I did that, so this is going back to the start where I was working with more senior stakeholders on giving them the fast-track ambassador. So I was collaborating with them on that whilst I set this work for the ambassador team. And that was a case of, okay, that was a very tight deadline. And it's kind of giving them the reassurance that, okay, look, we're going to get these ambassadors. It's going to take a bit of time, but I've taken a personal approach. I've asked them to explain the importance. Just bear with me a little bit and we'll get it. And it worked because rather than giving reaching out to file streamers and giving the generic spiel about why they should be ambassadors, it was explaining the importance of it and explaining to the stakeholders that it might take a bit of time, but we can get there. So there's a lot there, I think I've just said. Let's go to what was the result. So I think as a result, I successfully managed to get the file stream ambassadors for the marketing team, the campaign ambassadors, and also my team, you know, from literally a few weeks ago where there was no team, where there was nothing, no governance, no structure, nothing. We're the functioning team and we did deliver some amazing outreach events. And I think the stat that I always sort of say or kind of illustrate is out of the feedback that we got. So out of the 120 responses, 100% said they were more likely to apply for the fast stream now. And overwhelmingly, there was a very positive response. And even the marketing campaign that was very successful and I got a lot of good feedback from the marketing team, and I got a recommendation on my LinkedIn from, you know, one of the guys that was there that was leading on it. And I think that year, following that campaign, was the year FastStream made the top 100. So I think I played a small role, but a important role in that. And yeah, that did that cover it?
So this was another example that scored me quite well. So just to note, this was from an old role as well, which was at EO grade, and I gave an SEO example from there. So if you are at an entry-level grade, there's no reason why you can't do or have examples that would count at a higher level. So generally speaking, for this one, it scored a 5, like communicate influence scored a 5, whereas my first one, changing and improving, only scored 4. I think there was a lot about aligning it to a purpose and trying to get everyone on board in terms of what we're trying to do, making it more personal, getting people to own their own areas of work, giving them sort of the autonomy. Going back to, okay, so negotiating consensus and getting everyone on board. Okay, that definitely did that. Definitely sort of got everyone on board with that, made sure they knew what they were doing, mentioned the purpose, what their role is, why it's important, giving them their roles, making it a clear team structure, and giving them autonomy, giving them support. So in that sense, I think it was definitely a good example. The last one is on developing self and others. And this is one where I scored the highest, basically. I scored a 6 for this one.
Okay, so yeah, the example I have is in, yes, yeah, it's a slightly different sort of future thinking capability gap context, if that makes any sense. But I will try to explain that. So as we all know, COVID-19 has had a massive impact on how we're working. I believe we're working from home today, if I'm correct. Yeah. So I think in this example, it's about the summer diversity into that GDS, and the capability gap in this context was that we've never really done any internship or anything like this on a remote basis. So we've not really had that organizational idea of how it's going to work, how we can do it, and all of that, basically, from onboarding to keeping them engaged in their roles to giving them coaching and mentoring and ensure they have the development. And you know, for me, it was okay as an early talent manager and thinking about the future of early talent, if you know, apprentices, grads, interns are going to be working from home remotely, then for me, I sort of need to make sure that I'm got the capability and awareness to be able to engage them on a remote basis if they're working remotely, and making sure that as an organization we also know what we're doing with that. So I made sure firstly that we continued to support the summer diversity internship because there was questions about, you know, not supporting it and pulling out. And I believe, I'm not sure if HMRC withdrew the bid, I think they may have, but I could be wrong, so I'm not going to say anything there, but some big departments did withdraw their bids. So for me, I was, okay, look, if remote is going to be the sort of future that we're looking at, if, you know, we're looking at the digital context and all of that, then I need to continue to support this. And I was also passionate about the whole D&I piece and make sure that, you know, we can create a internship experience that's, if it can be inclusive and supportive for those that are from disadvantaged backgrounds, then surely that could be applied wider and we could really make it good for, even better for others. So this was my opportunity to work on that, and I took it, I really grasped it, and I really wanted it to continue. So the first thing, I think, for me was identifying with the business units whether their roles are still going to be suitable for the remote working, and kind of looking at that, navigating that basically, and make sure that, okay, this is where we are now, we're at home. Is it still possible to work with intern? Are there any objectives that we need to maybe adjust and make sure that was in place so the intern has the right role and the right stretch? And kind of coordinating that. I also set up an induction, and, you know, this wasn't the traditional, you know, half day induction that we might normally do. I realized, you know, although these young people, they've been at home for a very long time, so I think they might be kind of fed up of just being in front of a screen and hearing someone just talk at them for a very long time. And so I thought, okay, we'll keep it shorter. But I, again, to make them feel, you know, really included, and even though it was remote, kind of saying, look, even though we had the issue with COVID, we still want to support this. You know, you guys are really important, and emphasizing that importance. And really, for me, it was giving the message of, as summer diversity interns, there are four principles that I want you guys to really embed. And that's humility, that's being yourself, that's being ambassadors of the scheme, and that's enjoying and making the most of it. And I use that induction to also give them sort of, you know, advice on how to make the most of a remote internship. For example, you know, leveraging your land network, because you're at home, you might not be able to see people in the office as freely, but if you use your land manager, for example, they'll have access to a new network. And also set the weekly catch-ups and use that as an opportunity to find out what they're getting up to, what have they been doing, have there been any issues, and also coaching like a new skill. So I think the first one, as the induction one, was about, you know, the importance, the why, the purpose. The second catch-up would have been about, or was about, taking the initiative and make sure, okay, if you're at home and you're feeling like you're not getting enough work, your land manager can't see you. So, you know, make sure you drop that message and contact me if you need any help with that. So again, it's kind of navigating all those little steps of a remote program that you won't know unless you're doing it. Because if you're, you know, just doing a normal program and all in office, it's a lot easier. But as an organization, we've not done that before. So it's building that capability and building my capability to know that. I also set them other tasks. So even though they were remote, it's like, can you guys create a virtual blog? Highlighting, showcasing your experiences and coordinating that and giving them the responsibility. So they can also work on their working together skills, collaborating and partnering skills on a sort of a remote scale, because for them, this is maybe the first job they might not know how to do. Whereas if they get familiar with it, then they're going to be in a much better position going forward. And also kind of getting them to meet our director general, having that sort of remote meeting with them, getting them familiar with sort of senior stakeholders. And for me, I was building an understanding of some of the challenges they faced and kind of using this to set out, okay, how can GDS now improve this going forward? One of the challenges that came up was, this time around, the internship was only 5 weeks, so we didn't get as much time. And maybe we would have wanted more time to do more group exercises. So I was like, okay, you know, that's a great suggestion. I would have known that if I didn't do this, and GDS would have known that if we didn't do this. So, and, you know, just tailoring each advice to each intern so they could approach me in time, drop me a Hangout message. We don't use Skype or Link. We have this thing called Hangouts. And again, tailoring that for them. And I think, as a result, it's still concluding right now, but the vast, I think if all of them, are on their way to achieving the fast pass, they're just submitting the applications and the forms and getting their confirmation. So the fast pass is the thing that will get them to the fast stream assessment center directly, as well as some coaching to support them with that. And one of the pieces of feedback I've received from a line manager was that this intern has been amazing. Like, she's taking initiative, she's asking the questions, she's doing all this. And I was very proud, because I knew that was some of the advice I embedded in and really emphasized. Say, look, make sure you go out, ask questions, find out about different areas of work, do this, and, you know, you'll be interested to be interesting, and, you know, be curious, and you'll get an amazing experience. And she got a 7-week extension, so that her placement is now going to end in end of October. So yeah, it's been really, I think, for me, capability wise, I've understood how to manage that a lot better. And as an organization, we know had to manage that a little bit. And it's kind of led on to me starting my coaching and mentoring qualification as well, and thinking about that in the context of virtual.
I think there was a follow-up here.
Yeah. Such as in the context of this example, was it just for myself generally? Yeah. Yeah, okay. So for this example, it was for me, my capability that I wanted to develop and grow was managing early talent individuals on a virtual basis and keeping them engaged, which I think I got a very good development from this. For me, I'm a lifelong learner. Like I mentioned, when I was doing my apprenticeships and I started, there were times where I wasn't getting the development, and that only really kickstarted my drive to want to develop and grow. So I regularly seek feedback from my land manager, and I'm very open to feedback. Even if you want to give me feedback right now, I'd be very open to it. I like brutal, honest feedback because I know I can grow and develop from it. And I think sometimes we shy away from that because we feel we might offend the other person. But no, I'm very on feedback, and I'm very keen to take steps out of my comfort zone. So when I started my role as a diversity events coordinator, one thing that I didn't mention was I had social anxiety in terms of going out and speaking in public. But in that role, within sort of the first 2 weeks, there was an opportunity for me to present in front of 100 far streamers, first time I've done a presentation, and I took it. And it was difficult, it was challenging, but for me, I realized, you know what, stepping out of my comfort zone is where I've really grown. Getting feedback from others is how I'm going to continue to get that other perspective that I won't normally get. Doing the sort of coaching and mentoring course right now is something that I want to develop even further, my coaching and mentoring skills. But there's always been like L&D courses that I always look at and I always want to do. If it's something that I think is going to align with where I want to head to, then I'm all for it. I'm all for it. And I love growing. Growth is something I'm really passionate about. I want to embed for everywhere I go.
So that was, developing self and others. And I think if you can tell from that example, I didn't just speak about how I developed myself and my capability, but it was also related to how I increased the capability or developed interns. And I think this is where it stood out and became a six. I mentioned how I developed the organization's capability in terms of managing interns and teaching and kind of developing that knowledge of how to manage interns on a remote basis as from organization context, because it's not been done before. So I think that's where there was a lot of value in that sense. So I can see why that perhaps was my strongest example. And I think they also asked on the follow-up about how it developed me, basically, or how I use it for my own development. And I kind of touched upon learning how to manage interns, kind of mentor slash coach them, and being someone that likes to continuously learn and develop and get feedback. So I touched upon those different things. I also realized, actually, this interview has strength questions as well. So these were the behavior questions: communicating, influencing, working together, developing self and others, and changing and improving, which was the first one, I should have said. One thing I should say as well is, one thing I can't really see, and one thing that I would have liked to have had with a video fitted and meltdown, was seeing my body language and how I was talking in the example, because I think that's something that's very forgotten, or maybe not considered as much when you're doing an interview. Why do I say this? Because when I have interviewed people, or when I have been on an interview myself, when you're putting out the body language, they actually do assess that now, especially with strengths. They look at, is this person engaged? Is this person animated? Is this person kind of, you know, got their hands moving? Are they showing the passion, the energy? Are they bringing that vibe to it? Or are they just sort of maybe reading off their notes, or just like really quiet, really timid, and not really portraying what it is? And normally the warm-up question they ask is a benchmark to see your engagement levels. And then they assess you on the rest of that based on that. So it's really important to bring that energy and passion and whatever you can to show that you're not just someone that's very timid and brings nothing in terms of the engagement side, but you are someone that's engaged in your examples and what you're doing. Before I conclude towards the end of the next stuff, let's go into the strengths. The interview questions, the competency ones, behavior ones, were approximately about 8 minutes long for each one. The strength ones, a lot more quick fire. There's no real structure. But it's kind of a bit of on your feet, because I didn't even say in the job spec they'd be asking me interview questions. I'm sorry, strength questions. It should have perhaps said that. But regardless, let's go into it and let's see if I can recall what strengths they asked me about. And you can see how I reacted and to each one and maybe waffled a little bit. But I think it was quite sincere. Let's see. First one.
Good question, yeah. So for me, again, going back to the why are we doing what we're doing? You know, what is the main?
So I think this was about
motivation. You know, what is the main purpose of the team? And yeah, why are we doing that? Because if we don't know the why, if we don't know our strategy, if we don't know our purpose, then there's going to be no direction. So to get the best out of a team, starting with the why, starting with the strategy, the direction, and saying, okay, look, this is why we're doing this. This is why it's important. This is how we're going to do it. And this is the areas of work we're going to get towards and to achieve it. And whether that's kind of, you know, delegating the works, working to the strengths of the team, make sure it aligns with their personal goals in terms of development, or, you know, organizational goals, and look at the sort of managing that with the business needs and training needs. I think it is, yeah, for me, it is that starting with the why, starting with the strategy, the direction, you know, getting the team, delegating, make sure they know what they're doing, their work, keeping in touch, checking in how they are, you know, and building that relationship, you know, having that, it's not just, you know, a sort of team member, it's someone like a colleague, like a, I'd say in the military, like a brother, sister, to an extent, you know, building that good relationship up where, you know, you're on the same side, you're working together, you're working towards the same goal, and yeah, understanding that and being there for the team and being a team player and acknowledging that, whether it's being a leader or whether it's just being a team member, it's also acknowledging that, you know, as a team, we need each other to function. And it's not my way or the highway, or it's not me, you know, being the best and you guys aren't that great. It's about, okay, how are we going to achieve things together? And how am I going to help you in that journey? And how are you going to help me in that journey? So I think if that spirit is there and that support is there, then I can't see why a team, you know, wouldn't shine. Did that cover it?
So I think that might have been about being a motivator or a team player or even an energizer. Was one of those. That doesn't really help, does it? But it's basically one of those in terms of my feeling is it's a team player / motivator. Let's see what the next one is. And I can clarify what the first one was asking about. Because I didn't make a note of this one.
I think I may have touched upon it a lot now. Yeah, it's for me to make things happen. There's two things. Number one, again, is so when it comes to, you know, the human being, it comes to the emotion, it comes to understanding, again, the why, you know, why are you doing what you're doing? So if you're on an apprenticeship, what are you looking to achieve? You know, why did you sign up for it? What's your main goal and how are you going to go about achieving that? So I think it's, again, the purpose and the why and aligning it with whatever it is that needs to be aligned with for them to want to achieve something. So if somebody's coming in as an apprentice and they're having a hard time or they're having a challenge or something, for me it's about, okay, remember why you started, remember why you applied, remember why you went through the whole process and what do you want to achieve at the end of it? And, you know, giving them that reminder, that kind of that boost to kind of get that out of there. And I think it's energy as well. If I'm coming in and just, you know, saying it, my arms folded, like, why are we doing it? Then no one's going to be engaged. So it's about having that energy level and, you know, bringing that energy level. Because again, if I'm bringing in the bad vibes, then it's only going to spread around. If I'm bringing in the positive vibes, then it's going to rub off on the team. And that could, you know, be a factor to make someone motivated and kind of role model certain behaviors. So the second part, I think, is making things, so not easy, but making things doable. And what I mean by that, so I could motivate someone to, you know, be the best football player in the world or whatever, but then if there's no opportunity for them to go play football, then how are they going to do it? Or if there's no opportunity for them to train, how are they going to do it? So it's about, number one, enabling the why, the motivation, the purpose, the energy, and then number two, giving them a way to go and do it. So here's the tools, here's what you need to do, here's what you need to learn, go and smash up.
That was motivator. Okay, number two was motivator. Number one, I'm still trying to figure out what number one was. Maybe by then I'll know. I'll remember. Let's go into the third one. So they asked me, I believe, four of these questions.
Common ground, I think, is the first thing. Finding out what are their motivations, what was their sort of agenda, what's their objectives, and does that align? If not, where can it align? Coming to a common ground. And I think if you have a common ground with someone, then and you build that bridge, like I would say, you know, when you've got a different point of view to someone, you've got to build the bridge, right? So you build the bridge, then you put your point across. Whereas if you don't have the bridge there, if you don't have that understanding there, then you're going to go straight into the water, and it could be a bit, you might be just swimming to the other side, you might not be, and yeah, that could just be a big problem. So I think for me, being an influencer again, yeah, building the understanding of somebody's motivations, objectives, their perhaps perspectives, and trying to align that with what mine could be. If it's different, or if it's common ground and there's things that we share together, then great. That's another way to kind of build that relationship up and that rapport up. Was there anything else I wanted to add? Yeah, and also I think to build influence up, it comes with competence as well. So if I'm showing that, you know, what I say I deliver, or you know what I'm saying actually has weight and substance, and you know prove it with actions or you know outcomes, then I think that kind of grows an influence, and you build that sort of reputation up. And you know when you're talking to different people or senior stakeholders, then you have that more of a an influence there.
Okay, that was influencer. Something to do with a question about influencing, basically, which doesn't help, but at least it gives you an idea of what other questions I could ask about. The next one is on, let's find out.
So it's how confident are you making decision and leading others?
Decision making and leading others.
Yeah, so confidence for me comes from competence. So if I'm coming into a brand new role, then I want to know or build my understanding of what goes on, how does it work, how can I deliver, and then using that to build up my competence, and that will grow in my confidence. And then when it comes to leading teams, it's that sort of same thing as well. Whereas, you know, if I'm showing that I can do it, if I'm showing that it's positive, that it's doable, and following up by being competent, showing the competencies, I guess, then when it comes to, you know, leading teams, and just to clarify again, so this is showing confidence and leading teams. Is it two separate ones or is it together?
So I had to quickly clarify the question because I forgot what the question was. So sometimes you might need to do that just to make sure you're answering the question okay. And it's focused.
Yeah, so I was missing that whole point about decisions. So decisions again. So coming from that, the competence side, knowing your stuff, knowing what you're talking about, and having a real understanding of the different areas, the implications, what could work, what could have worked, what to try, and having that feel of, okay, I'm confident that I can take this managed risk and to take this leap and try this. But however, you know, if the saying goes, that's going to have a potential big repercussion, then it's like, okay, wait, no. So I think having the confidence first when it comes to making decisions is the competence, knowing what's out there, knowing the context and background, having the knowledge, ensuring you can do it as well. And then when it comes to leading teams, personally, when I sort of see leaders, for me, it's someone that knows what they're doing. Someone that, again, touching upon what I mentioned, has understanding of the implications of the decisions of, you know, what they're deciding, what repercussions that could have, expertise in their sort of area, knowing the context. And if I know someone has that, then when they make a decision, for me, I'll be happy to sort of follow that. And I think for me, if I'm leading others, then if I'm making the decision, that I need to prove that I have the confidence, and that's by showing that I've got the competence for it. And yeah, if I have that, then I recommend when it comes to leading others and getting them on board, then that needs to be there. Without that, then my leadership, and I won't be seen as a competent leader, and that's going to defeat the whole purpose of, you know, being a leader, being able to make effective decisions and leading others.
I learned this from my mentor in episode 3. So this is now the end of the interview, but this isn't an interview in the whole sense. What can I add here? So number one, you may have heard a lot of sirens living in East London, does that, so do excuse that. One thing I guess which is quite important is asking questions. So I mentioned about the body language stuff already, because I couldn't show the videos, so I couldn't show the body language. But the second part is asking questions. This is where you again can leave another good impression and, you know, get them thinking that you're really interested in the job. You know, if you're asking about, okay, how much do you get paid, or is there flexible working hours? Okay, that's great. You can ask that later on, but then that doesn't even show why you might be interested in the program or the role or anything like that. So here, these are some of the questions that I asked. If I can get that up, let's see.
I guess my first question would be, what advice would you give to somebody in this role? But you touched upon a lot of interesting stuff. I think the HR, CIPD, we've got tech masters for the security professionals. There's a level 6 cybersecurity. There's that coaching and mentoring stuff. It's something I'm currently like working on in GDS, and I've been doing a lot of work on that. So there's definitely stuff there we could look at. I guess one other thing I wanted to clarify was the location of the role, because I noticed on the job ad, it had Bristol and London. On the job description, it mentioned Bristol. Is there scope to be based in regional hubs like Stratford, London, or is it? Final question, I've questions at the time and don't want to take up too much of your time either. So next steps, when should I expect to hear back or stuff like that, basically? Open to honest, brutal feedback, or honest and open feedback. So if I am successful, I'll still like some feedback. If I'm not successful, then please.
Okay, so what happened there was, I didn't show the whole thing, but when I asked the first question, they sort of answered all my questions. And since my second question was going to be, so what are the main challenges in this role, basically? And that was going to be about this place. What they sort of said was, this is a new area of work. There's not really been anything done here. And somebody would come in and pick up quite a lot of different things. And I sort of said, okay, that sounds great, because that's what I'd done in my previous role. Doing my current role as a talent manager, so starting from scratch and building up from the ground up. So it kind of really aligns in that sense. So answering it, or so reinforcing why I'm quite suitable for the role. Other things I would have asked, which I'm not sure why I didn't ask him, maybe because I had it in the conversations that I was talking to him. I was having conversations with them, and I may have covered it already. But stuff like, you could talk about, okay, what development opportunities do you think this role could offer? You know, what projects are there to get involved in? And what are the, I guess you could ask, what are the deliverables? What are you expecting someone to deliver in this role? So these are just some of the things that you can ask in terms of the questions, and it's good to ask the right questions and questions that show you're interested and really, you know, want this role, and not just ask for the sake of it. And you can also ask stuff about location, work patterns, all that. That's important as well. But the first thing you should ask about more is about the role, I think, because again, it shows you're interested and you're on it, in terms of you want to know what the role is about. And then the last thing I asked about was, or I requested.
Okay, perfect. And I think, yeah, just to end off with, as I mentioned in the interview, I'm very open to honest, brutal feedback, or honest and open feedback. So if I am successful, I'll still like some feedback. If I'm not successful, then please do let me know which area of, I guess, behavior that I could really improve on and work on. And I'll love that. I really appreciate that. Thank you so much. That was lovely. Take care. Bye.
Lovely speaking to you.
Right.
So I did end up getting some feedback. So the general comments were, so I scored again pretty well. I scored 5s in the strengths. Depends, scored me experience, scored me 4, but I'm not sure what exactly scored me on with experience. And that's apparently where the other individual scored in front of me somehow, but I'm not totally sure how that worked. But basically what they said was, a very strong interview from an engaging candidate who's a good fit for the role in the team, demonstrated good evidence across all areas, and particularly strong on developing self and others, demonstrated very impressive people skills, both in terms of leading teams and working with stakeholders, also has an impressive grasp of how to land change successfully. Another candidate had a high level experience suitable for the role, but Rahul is a very strong first reserve. So yeah, that's the interview that I did for an SEO role in civil service. And yeah, I think this is a unique thing to be listening to, because you normally don't get a chance to actually sit in or listen to a real life interview. So this wasn't a mock, this wasn't me practicing, this was actually the real thing. And I hope that you can really think about this and learn, you know, what went well here, what didn't go well, what could you do better. It's quite important. And to end with, you know, I really want to sort of leave with a reflection question is, you know, if you were to rate yourself from like a scale of 1 to 6, 6 being amazing at interviews, being engaging, you know, having no fault, no stuttering, nothing, to 1 being, okay, there is like a bit of stuttering, a bit of kind of lack of confidence, but an opportunity to develop, where would you rate yourself from that 1 to 6? That's my first question. And once you answer that question, my next question for you is, how can you work your way up to a 6? Really think about that. Is it practice? Is it more research? You know, what is it exactly that you need to do to get yourself up from that, you know, that rating, which I'm going to assume that is going to be below 6, to get up to a 6. And if you scored yourself a 6, then I don't know why you listen to this podcast. You didn't need to. But okay, Jazakallah here for listening. I hope you find this useful. Please do, you know, share some comment, share some feedback, and, you know, give a like and subscribe, you know, if you find this beneficial, and share it with others that could really benefit from getting a real insight into a real interview and how they can prepare their examples and learn from it. And if there are any questions, just drop it in the comments below. But Jazakallah here for listening. I hope you find this really beneficial. Asalaamu Alaikum.